Voilà. Voilà, le professeur Younous est avec nous.
Professor Younous is now with us, so we're very happy to welcome him again. Welcome, Mohamed Younous, and good celebration for this 10th anniversary of the Nobel Peace Prize. I'm going to give you a very first piece of information that I'm sure will be of interest to you. We've been sort of touring since the beginning of the week. Hello to all of you. On Monday, we're in Lille, yesterday in Strasbourg, today in Grenoble, tomorrow in La Rochelle, Friday morning in Paris. And then we'll come back home on Friday evening for the recap of this very interesting week of exchange and sharing of information. We'll be on Lille on Friday evening. So this is the result of the talent of this gentleman. We are quite similar, so that's why I quite like him in terms of hairdo. So this is our trademark. CSE is obviously something quite interesting. Meloto has got hair. That's a bit of annoying. Never mind. So he's been actually listening to our plenary, and with his talent, he's trying to summarize our exchanges. And this morning, around what Mr. Younous said, we explored the immense and surprising fields of social business. Social businesses create long-lasting profit with a view to redistributing it for the well-being of people. In the field of health, education, etc. So we spoke about that this morning. If you can now go on the streaming line of the World Forum, you can see the hashtag there on the right-hand corner. You can see and download that. And we've got that for every single of our plenaries. There's another piece of information. Marie is here. She's going to talk about the impact of the digital economy on events such as this. We come across 4,000 or 5,000 people throughout the event, but the digital buzz that basically you get enables us to actually get in touch with a larger public. And up to now, on the end of the third day, we spoke to the World Forum to how many people? So we broadcast it with something 3 million people.
3 million person online, and I'm pretty sure that we will be 3 million person if Professor Younous make a tweet. So Professor Younous, if you like to tweet, you're more than welcome. Donc il y a presque 3 million personnes.
People have been able to see that 3 million people. 5,000 contents have been broadcast by 1,200 different people, so you're more than welcome to join that club. Of course, round of applause, you're right. Great. So we're lucky enough to have Antonio Meloto, with whom we will conclude this session, and a pleasure to welcome again Mr. Professor Younous. Professor, so in this school, when we started preparing the World Forum and this particular day of events, a group of students got together to try and work, and they worked quite hard, actually, repeatedly, on the idea of Nobel Prizes. The generic theme of the forum is businesses, what can you do with it? And they thought about what can you do with a Nobel Prize. So I'd like you to listen to the result of their get together, and you're going to see it now, straight there in front of you. Let's go. Hello, everyone. If we are here today to celebrate, of course, the 10th anniversary of the award of the Nobel Peace Prize to Mr. Younous. Hello, Mr. Professor. With our working group, we thought about the impact of Nobel Prizes throughout the world. And we wondered what could be tomorrow's Nobel Prizes. And without further ado, I'll ask you to welcome a candidate to the Peace Prize. What is a Peace Nobel Prize? It's a committed man who shows, displays the ability to be a true exemplary example. But who are the best Nobel Prizes? It's those who, in the image of Mr. Yunus, open a way that nobody knew how to follow, or at least share in the open for it with everyone. Men whose vision takes into account today's reality and tomorrow's dreams. It's having this made this assessment, I decided to stand up in this honorable lineage of great men of peace. You know what the greatest problem of humanity is? The lack of empathy. How can we remedy this? I'm going to ask you a question. What is uglier than a mollusk? Do you feel concerned by the cause of bollocks? No? And if that changed, if you all of a sudden became sensitive to the cause of mollusks, join my fight for the well-being of mollusks, because whilst learning to love mollusks, then you'll help me learn men. My apologies for this incident. So without further ado, another candidate for the Peace Prize, for the Literature Peace Prize. How can you actually ensure that you seize the quintessential value of the life of the seagulls? Hello. So this major work from our repertoire is an haiku, which I took 10 years to write, 10 very long years. I would like to remind you of how a haiku is composed, 7 feet, 5 feet, 7 feet. It is called, as the organizer just said, the soft and latent fleeting melancholy of the life of a rhododendron, or how to grasp the quintessential value of the metabolism of seagulls. Melancholy of the rhododendron and quintessential seagulls. Thank you. Thank you very much. So without further ado, now we have the contender for the Medicine Peace Prize. Ever since, I've been sad. So I did a study on the various elements that could trigger anxiety, angst, and depression on the basis of my own observations. So I'll give you a few examples of these elements that can actually do that. When your husband leaves you, when your friends abandon you, when you lose your job, when you have a car accident, when you have to have a serious disease, when you know that you are sentenced to condemned to death, when your house is set on fire, when you have to present the work of your life and you've never drawn any tangible conclusions. So, now the contender for the prize, Nobel Prize for Chemistry. Well, that was rather quick. I suspect that we've now seen all the contenders, unless you have something to declare. Ah, you have got something to say? Because, sorry? I've always wanted to have a Nobel Prize, but even if one person here has been lucky or has deserved to be appointed not for one but two categories of Nobel Prizes, most of us, like you and me, well, we're not normally nominated for any prize whatsoever. Well, it's a shame, because if I've learned something from Mr. Yunus said, is that he said everyone can actually be an entrepreneur. If everybody can do so, it means that everybody can bring something to the world. And if everyone can bring something to the world, it means that we all deserve to have a Nobel Prize. So I've created my own new categories of Nobel Prizes, starting with a Nobel Prize of Nobel Prizes, i.e. myself. Because if you don't believe in what you do, no one will. Then I've also created other categories, for example, the Prize Nobel Prize for Sport, Cooking, or Math. Minus 600 poor in the world. Okay, that's enough. That's enough. That's enough of that. Out. Apologies again for this pathetical presentations. But without further ado again, I wanted to welcome here the only person who really deserves a Nobel Prize, who, after he got that 10 years ago, has relentlessly crisscrossed the world to share his conviction that another economy is possible, based on sharing social transformation with one objective, that this in this world there might be zero poverty tomorrow. He's here in Grenoble, us to lead us with him in his formidable adventure, Mr. Mohamed Yunus.
Upon the Nobel Peace Prize laureate for 2006, Mohamed Yunus, to come forward to receive the gold medal and the diploma.
Que vos applaudissements couvrent ceux de ce film.
This was done 10 years ago, of course, 10 years and 2 months ago in Oslo. Nobel Peace Prize to Mr. Yunus.
Thank you. It's wonderful to be here. And all the skits that I just saw on Nobel Peace Prize, I hope we can take this show to the next ceremony, which is coming up in December. They will enjoy it very much, what it means to everybody. It's a really amazing thing that suddenly you are told that you got the Nobel Peace Prize or some Nobel Prize. And I'm really overwhelmed that you are celebrating the 10th year of the Nobel Peace Prize for me. I'm on the road, I'm not at home. People have been missing this particular date in Bangladesh. It was a fantastic news for all of Bangladesh that somebody from Bangladesh got the Nobel Peace Prize. This was amazing news for the whole country. And for me, it's again one occasion when suddenly you feel something happened in your life that makes a big difference. I have been talking about what you mentioned during your skit about what human beings are all about the entrepreneurship, about even the poorest person can unleash her own capacity to change her life and touch the lives of the other people. Many of these things I've been saying for years, but people didn't pay much attention to it. Some thought it's a crazy thought. How can you say that all people are entrepreneurs? It's not possible. Not everybody's made to be entrepreneur, and all kinds of explanation. I understand that. It's my view, but I don't want to fight with them. Some thought it's a stupid thing he says all the time. It doesn't make any, it has no relevance whatsoever in the life of the people. But something happens after you get the Nobel Peace Prize. Suddenly, same thing when I say, now sounds like a very wise thing to say. Absolutely out of the world. So I was wondering, what changed? Yesterday I said the same thing, people told these those things are stupid ideas, and suddenly today it becomes a wise word. That is the magic of the recognition which is given by Nobel Prizes all across, particularly in areas of social science and so on. It makes so much difference. And suddenly the doors which were never opened for me, I tried to hit them, knock them. It's very difficult to open them. The moment the prize is announced, it becomes so easy. Before you even arrive, doors are open. And people that you wanted to meet, never could meet, suddenly they are the ones coming to see you. So that is the kind of legitimacy, the recognition that the prize grants you. But at the same time, I have to be very careful when I felt that I realized that this is a very short-lived attention of the whole world. When the Nobel Prize is announced, I was not aware that I'm going to get a Nobel Prize. I was just living the normal everyday life on that day. Suddenly a phone call comes. He said, I'm calling you from Norway. Do you know today the Nobel Peace Prize will be announced? I said, I have no idea. I was not thinking about that. He said, there's a speculation in Oslo that you may be one of the possible candidates who may be announced today as a Nobel Prize recipient. I said, I never heard of that. I didn't see anything in our press. So no, there's a strong speculation here in Oslo. I said, well, what can I do about it? It's not something. I was in an interview with someone in Delhi. He was interviewing me. So this was an interruption. I said, well, thank you very much for calling. Let me go back to my interview. He said, please don't go back. Hang on for a while. I said, no, I have to finish this interview. He said, well, keep this telephone open. Don't use it for any other purpose. If I call you back, please pick it up. I said, okay. So I went back regularly. I was just being interviewed by the interviewer. Suddenly, the phone rings, I pick it up. I said, the announcement is about to come. Why don't you listen to it? Then I realized maybe somebody is pulling my leg, saying all those things. I was not paying much attention to it. He said, no, this is real. You listen to it and hear what they have to say. I said, okay, put it on. He said, I'm right in the chamber where it's being announced. So I hear the announcement in Norwegian language. I don't understand a word what's going on. Suddenly I hear Muhammad Yunus. I said, no, this is, maybe he's just talking about the short list. There may be other names in it. Then say Grameen Bank. I said, no, there's no other name, just two words. Then he congratulated me. I said, I still don't believe it. You heard it. So that was the beginning of it. And within half an hour to 40 minutes, the entire world's media right in front of my door and trying to interview me, because now suddenly I became a very special person. So from then on, the whole thing started flowing and changing life-changing event. The one I'm saying that I realized that this may not be long-lived, it will be short-lived, because next year, around the same time, another Nobel laureate will be announced, and people's entire attention will be him or on her. Nobody will pay attention to you anymore. So I said, as long as I have the attention, why don't I try to explain what I do so that people can remember, at least that they will be interested in what I'm doing. If they can do something, that will be a tremendous thing to happen. But luckily, that door remains open even today. I'm very happy. The responses that I got from the work that I do, and so many friends that I've received, and particularly the friends from France. It's an amazing support that I've received from France in very concrete ways, expanding my idea into concrete things. Big companies in France like Danone. Danone has become a classic example of our work because they showed that it's something, it's a genuine business, and everybody, all other businesses paid attention to it. And all the young people in France have been enormously supportive and wanted to do things. I have visited many times since then to meet the young people in France to talk about what we do and the excitement that I see from them. And I'm totally convinced human beings can create the world they want. They don't have to inherit anything they have. They can design their own world and be in it. That is the power of human being. That is the power of young people. If you can imagine a world that you, what kind of world you want, if you just imagine, it will happen. If you don't imagine, it will never happen. So please imagine the world that you want. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Merci beaucoup. Restez debout. Restez. Ce sont ces 10 ans de prix Nobel. Alors, on discutait tout à l'heure avec Jean, aujourd'hui, demain, c'est aujourd'hui. Et ce sont les 10 ans du World Forum. Alors, pour la communauté là, des 3 millions et peut-être 5 à la fin de la semaine, on va faire tous ensemble, version française, version anglaise, un joyeux anniversaire. Professor Common, come on, take place here. Okay.
So we have the GoPro, just a second, so we have to press on the button. Come on, all the stand-ups, come here, I'll introduce you afterwards. So okay, a little bit of organization there. I'll count to three and we'll say happy birthday in French. Okay, you ready? One, two, three.
Alors,
so, I was expecting just a happy birthday, but you went through the whole song. Well, let's do it in English now. Okay, ready? Are you ready?
Un,
one, two, three.
Birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Mouma. Happy birthday to you.
Merci beaucoup.
Thank you very much. Stay standing, please. Stay standing up because I want to introduce to you our actors. It's a working group that is somewhat specific. In the school, there are two drama clubs, one based on improvisation called Impropulsion, and then there's another club, a drama club called Assénique. And they wanted to do something. The idea came from them. So we have Muriel Léonard. Here she is. So they should have the Nobel Prize for Drama. Laetitia Munch. Pierre Le Sueur. Julien Pesanti, our moderator. And Ombre Andiamana. So there we are. So that's for posterity. Antonio, same thing with you in about 15 minutes, so get ready. Thank you very much for your participation, and applause for Professor Younes once more. Bye-bye, Jean. Now, we also have the pleasure of the immense pleasure of having with us today, if I can have a little silence, please. They're all saying bye-bye, bye-bye, well done, we're all happy, and happy anniversary. So we have the immense pleasure of having with us today another person who inspires, another personality who has acted in their country, the Philippines. And that is Antonio Melotto. He's here. Let's give him a round of applause. Antonio, I won't be in front of the microphone later on. The students of this school have worked on questions that they will be asking you in the discussion that we will have with you. So you've come along with your team. You've come along with your team, we'll come back to this. Your exemplary action around Gawad Kalinga has led to spin-offs. So hundreds and thousands of people have joined the movement with Antonio Melotto. People who have had access to the basics of life, food, water, training, education, health. These are the first questions, the first problems that he had to solve. And then when these people within the 2,400 communities got up, he was able to think about entrepreneurship activities, social entrepreneurship activities. So he took on hundreds of entrepreneurs where he created his communities. And he's brought some of them with him today. These are the stand-ups of the World Forum. You'll be hearing three fantastic testimonies. The rule of the game for the stand-up is to stand in the yellow circle and to say something for 10 minutes. Today, we've suggested that they talk about a specific theme inspired by the action of Tony Melotto. What if we were able to dream? Entrepreneurs and Dream Builders. This was the first book produced in 2009. Entrepreneurs and Dream Builders. They build dreams, he build dreams that become reality. Now, the first is Fabien Courtet. He is one of those people who created his own business. He undertook his business producing educational toys produced in the Philippines and adapted to children and respectful of the environment. So he has help from mums who manufacture the toys with young people in the communities that they've set up. So these products are entirely manufactured by hand. And then there's a key word behind this, and that is spin-offs. Here we create in order to spin off elsewhere. So let's give him a huge round of applause. A huge round of applause for Fabien Courtet. Here he is. Oh, he hasn't got a microphone. What's happening? So, no, he's doing a stand-up, so he needs a proper microphone. Fabien, give him another big round of applause. Stand in the middle of the yellow circle. Can we try and kit people out with microphones, the next stand-ups, with microphones, please? This will be very quick. So you've got a timer in front of you, Fabien. You've got 10 minutes. Hopefully it will work. Let's do a quick test. Ladies and gentlemen, Fabien Courtel. No sound. He has to go back up to test. He has to go back into the technical room. Hello. Ah, there we are. So Fabien Courtel. Hello, everybody. Hello. So I've already lost 30 seconds. It's going to be more complicated. No, we stopped the timer. But it's a privilege to be before you today and to talk to you after Professor Younous and before Tony Minotto. So I think I'm very, very lucky. It's very emotional to come back to Grenoble. This is where I did my master's degree, not in this school, but in the school in Saint-Martin-d'Hères, but it's in Grenoble. And before leaving for the Philippines, a country that I wasn't familiar with, during my entrepreneurship master's, I wondered what I wanted to do with my life, what kind of company I wanted to set up. And I'm sure it's a question that many entrepreneurs and students are asking themselves, what kind of company can I set up? And what kind of company is it going to be? There are certain cases we see on television or in the papers. We're hearing about 6,000, 7,000 layoffs, whereas the business manager is earning 150 times more than employees. So I wanted to do things differently. I wanted to remove myself from my context and do different things. And I heard about Gawad Kalinga, so I went to see Tony Milotto to see what he did. I don't know whether I can maybe use my slides. Here they are. So the story that I'm going to tell is how a French person lands into the Philippines to make soft toys. I come from Cherbourg. Cherbourg, is not everybody knows Cherbourg. So how did I get to the Philippines? So I got to this place called the Enchanted Farm. And the first time I had heard about it, it was described as the Silicon Valley of social business, Google, Microsoft, all of these big brands. So at the same time, Tony said it was the Disneyland of social tourism. So you can imagine it with all the toys, all of the attractions in the middle of Google and Microsoft. So I was also told it was the Harvard of social education. So you imagine a university, a campus with all of that. And when I arrived, there was absolutely nothing. There was nothing, just land, plants that were fairly high. It was the old hiding place of rebels in the Philippines. So I asked Tony if... He was taking the Michael out of me or if I'd missed something. And he said, it's up here in your head, and this is where you have to build. So I said to myself, well, he hasn't chosen the right person because I'm not a carpenter, I'm not a welder, so I don't see what I can do. But at the same time, I was very inquisitive. Why not, I said to myself, why not create the first Silicon Valley for social business in the Philippines? So I went to the villages, I went to that village, and we'll hear about that more. There are many small villages, people who have been rehoused, people who are trying to start life again. And the question is, now that we've housed people, now that they're set up, what happens? Are they going to go back to cities, become squatters? Are they going to go back to cities and look for jobs? So that's the problem. You know, how do you find solutions through social business? So I said, why not use what I've learnt in terms of entrepreneurship in school? So when you look at the Philippines, it's a country that has millions of enterprise opportunities. There are many things to do. There are millions of hectares of land that hasn't been developed. It's very fertile. It's got many living species that are endemic to the Philippines. So it has many opportunities, but they import absolutely everything. Farmers are 58 years on average. What they consume is imported. So there's this side of things. And within this village, on the side, you can see the houses on the side to the right. That's where I was housed. That's where I was accommodated, in one of the houses that was smaller than my apartment here in Grenoble. There were already seven people living in there. But they gave me a space for my bedroom. So there was a bamboo bed. It wasn't hugely comfortable, with a mosquito net. And my colleagues, the people sharing my bedroom were hens. And as I listened to people, I realized that there were many stories, notably the women in the village who worked as seamstresses for big textile industries that made bags or that were sold in France. They'd lost their jobs over the past 10 years. So there were 200 companies that had closed, so 3,000 women who found themselves without a job from one day to the next. And these women were the women who housed us. And I thought, well, it's not fair. And the only opportunity they had was to become cleaners in big cities in Singapore. So I thought, right, this is what I need to do. I need to create a company. I worked with my host family, and I tried to provide a new opportunity and to work on their dignity and to provide them with a means of subsistence. So I didn't know anything about sewing. I still don't know how to use a sewing machine, and I didn't want to make dresses or bags or whatever. But there's something else in the Philippines that struck me. It's a country where there are thousands and thousands of children everywhere. And even if they don't know you, they come to you, they smile at you, they ask if you're American. So they'll they say, Kuya, big brother. So I had 1 million brothers and sisters from one day to the next. I don't know whether my parents went to the Philippines before. They never said anything to me. But the Philippines, it's incredible. All of these children, they didn't have any toys. They played with plastic bottles. They played with bicycle tires. And I said to myself, why not? I'll work with my host family, and we'll use their potential in terms of sewing. We'll create soft toys that we'll give to the children so that they can also have toys, so that they can grow up with toys. So we launched the company for producing toys, and I wanted to make sure that there were a certain number of values, because most toys are made in China on big production lines with people who don't necessarily have great working conditions. So I wanted to make sure that the soft toys would be produced in a healthy manner for the children. We wanted to make sure as well that the love for Philippines should be demonstrated, that people would be proud of them coming from the Philippines. I wanted to make sure that this changed the life of the families we worked with. Otherwise, why bother doing it? And then little by little, we created this brand, Plush and Play. Plush, which means a soft toy, and Plush and Play. Now, given that it's called the Enchanted Farm, why we decided to work on fruit and vegetable soft toys. And little by little, we realized that in the Philippines, there were no Philippine toys. So we wanted to create stories about these personalities. So I don't know if you know Manny Pacquiao, the boxer. So we created the soft toy, the watermelon. It's called Manny Pacquiao, and Pacquiao is the word for watermelon. So there's Cindy Crawford, there's Billy Crawford. I don't know if you know him. He's from the Philippines. So we've got a red pepper called Billy Crawford. And we gave them names according to celebrities. This is one of the most popular celebrities, one of the most influential women with 12 million people following her on the social media. So our tomato is called after her. And the first soft toy that I did was this tomato. And the first sample, tomato sample, was terrible. It looked like ketchup. It was horrible. I was the worst toy manufacturer in the world, especially in the Philippines. But little by little, we made progress. We worked with the women in the community. And now this small tomato, it's gone a long way. We've created more and more soft toys. These are the women with whom we work. That's our workshop. We've got different sizes, different soft toys, different fruit and vegetable. And in terms of production, as I said, I didn't know how to use a sewing machine, so it really involved a lot of collaboration and collective work. They make the soft toys at home. We work together. We teach people how to make the soft toys. We see children. They make their own soft toys in the workshop. It's part of the experience. So people behind the machine, who were behind a machine in a big company, who were never exposed to the public, now can share their knowledge and their know-how with anybody. And that gives a meaning to their lives. It allows them a certain amount of dignity. When I started in the toy industry, I said, well, the biggest client is going to be children. And in fact, my biggest clients are companies. We make mascots, key rings. So this is something that I love. Big companies, they're not enemies. In many cases, when you talk about NGOs or social business, so big companies are seen as devils. But here we found a means of working with big companies to help people who are underprivileged in rural areas. So this is the marketing mix. I'm sure that you study the 10 pieces of the marketing mix. I think a social entrepreneur has to be more innovative. So there are 10 here, 10 P's, Pinot touch. It's better than French touch because it starts with an F. So Pinot touch is the word in Filipino. So social business also means changing the game little by little. When you start doing things like this that are interested, the media follows you. So you've got an increasing number of media people who come and tell the story. I don't know how much you pay to put your advert on the television, but when we do things in social business, lots of people want to share your story, want to tell your story, and it's part of what we've developed. So there are many people who've promoted our products, and little by little, we decided to go into toy shops. We became the first Filipino soft toy to be sold in a shop in the Philippines. And I'm not even Filipino. I'm a French entrepreneur taking Filipino toys to Filipino shops. Our stand is often next to brands like Walt Disney in trade fairs. So we've set up next to them, and it's difficult to compete with them. So there are some things that we wanted to make sure. We wanted to emphasize this Filipino brand. So we got the captain of the basketball team to come along. So it's a bit like getting Zinedine Zidane to come along to your toy shop. So he's the captain of the basketball team, so an ambassador showing the image of the Philippines. And for the first time in my life, playing basketball was not a handicap. When I was doing my studies, my teachers always said, stop playing basketball, it's a waste of time, you won't get your diploma. Well, for once, it made me able to invite the captain of the team. So you can see the stand, there are weighing scales, there are soft toys. It's like you're being at the market. We organized an event as well. We got the women from the rural village to come to the biggest malls so that people could make their own soft toys in the mall. Now, of course, the Chinese are not going to do this. They're not going to bring their sewing machines over to the Philippines. They're not going to bring over their children. That wouldn't work. And it's not politically correct. So we also try and have this competitive advantage also. So we created this kind of activity. So not long ago, we became the first soft toy to take part in this exhibition. I'm the first French person to do this. One of the objectives is to... We created a stand that was twice as big as L'Opiti, and we built it ourselves. So it's fairly tiring. For 3 days, we created a real garden with a market where people can come along and pick their green beans, their tomatoes, and then they go and pay for them, they weigh them, they pay for them. So we created a whole universe about this. And when you're a social entrepreneur, you want it to be a company. It has to work. There has to be a return on investment. It has to continue to move forward. It's not just a six-month project. It's a project that has to be for the long term with as many people involved as possible. So it has to have impact from a social and point of view. So we work with 50 women who work from their homes. They do the sewing, the cutting, and they do it from home. And they organize, they're organized in small teams. It means that they can spend more time with their husbands, their children. I shouldn't really say that. But anyway, it gives them more freedom to manage their timetable. One of the things that we're going to do is to make sure that the Filipino soft toys can travel across the world to show what's manufactured in the Philippines is world class. So I have them with me in my rucksack. We'll go up to the Bastille and take some photos later on. So if you're interested, you can take these and post them. So hand-stitched with love and stuffed with dreams. One of our dreams is to become a Hello Kitty, to create a whole universe with stories that allow us to tell all of these lovely stories and for children so that they know what social business is, so that, we can share the values. So we're going to replace this with our personalities. Hello Kitty is going to disappear. So that's part of our dream. Our company is called Plush and Play. If you want to know more, you can have a look at our website. The address is on the screen. Thank you very much. So, dream builder. Now we have a female dream builder, Camille. Camille is a social entrepreneur and has two passions, her country, the Philippines, and cosmetic products. And she's brought both together to create her company to help with human development. I forgot to say, she's called Camille Melotto. Welcome, Camille.
Hello, everyone. I'm Camille, and I'm a social entrepreneur from the Philippines. So for any social entrepreneur, there would be a trigger as to why we start our journey as a social entrepreneur. But for me, especially, it's because of that guy. So there is such a person as him named Antonio Melotto, who says things like, "This country has no excuse to be poor." And he happens to be my father. So when you wake up every single morning with these kinds of messages that you get for, you know, breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and maybe even like midnight snack, there is something that would be really implanted and conditioned in your brain. And so basically because of this, it enabled me, my sister, and my brother-in-law to start something and to really integrate what our dad has started into our dreams in our lives. So basically, our dad had this dream to end poverty in the Philippines. And I just want to show you some before and after pictures of Gawad Kalinga for transforming slums into nice villages and enabling students to have education and all these things. So because of this, there is, in 2008, there were already 2,000 villages and 2,000 communities in the whole of the Philippines that have been transformed. And so where did we come in? So there's still a need for sustainable livelihood because there have already been villages that have been transformed, so there is a need to provide livelihood for them. And that's where we really wanted to come in. So me, my sister, and my brother-in-law came up with our company called Human Nature. Human Nature, we have this vision. Our vision is we will be the gold standard of a globally successful enterprise with a heart that will embolden all businesses to better serve society. So basically, we really want to influence not just ourselves as an enterprise, but also influence others to think about social entrepreneurship and even traditional companies to think about social entrepreneurship. So how did we do this? We are a company that manufacture and produce natural cosmetics in the Philippines. And we have these three main values. So we are pro-Philippines. 100% of our manufacturing is done in the Philippines. And then we are also pro-poor because we really have this track to alleviate the poverty with our employees, with our communities, etc. And we also are pro-environment because we are coming up with biodegradable and natural, sustainable products. So when we were thinking about our company, we were thinking, oh, you know, 2,000 communities, that's a lot of people. So when we thought about that, we can't come up with a company that was thinking small scale. So you really had to think macro. So when we think about it, toothpaste, shampoo, bar soaps, makeup, all these things are everyday things that you use in your everyday life. I don't think anybody here does not use shampoo. I don't think anybody here does not use bar soap. So we really tried to come up with our company to be able to influence as many as we can. So we have very unique things that we do in our business. One of them is, in the Philippines, a huge problem is job security. And so us in Human Nature, we made it a point that we will have no contractual work so that there will be security for our employees. Aside from that, once you have been regularized in our own company, we have in no way can we ever fire you. So we have a no firing policy. Have you ever heard of this before? No, it's a very crazy and radical thing that we came up with, but it's the only way for us to be able to work with the communities and be there for them. And we can't give up on them. That's why we have to continuously develop them, and then we cannot fire them. Aside from that, we're also the first cosmetics company in the Philippines that's certified cruelty-free by PETA. So that's something that we are also very proud of. And in the Philippines, there is no such thing as a natural standard. In the whole of Asia, there's actually no standard for naturalness, but we want to continuously push further and further the quality standards. So we applied for Natural Products Association in America and became certified by them. And now if you look at their website, we are the only brand that has the most number of certified natural products in there, going even beyond the American brands and beyond the other brands. So can you imagine a social enterprise that's able to do this? I think it's something that is like already a dream come true for us. Next, we are also able to enable our own employees to also become from beneficiaries to be benefactors themselves. So we came up with this program called Goodness Rising. So 100% of our best-selling product, which is a bug repellent, is actually going back to the farming community. So we have these radical things, aside from the no firing policy, such as this, which help the farming communities. And not only that, it's also because of the heroism of our own employees, such as they donate 10% of their monthly wages for donating to like the typhoon Haiyan victims. And so because of this, we were able to come up with 120 houses for a community that we built, which you can see here with the Human Nature Children's Park. We also provide scholarships for seed in the GK Enchanted Farm that Fabian was talking about. So because of this, you would think we won't be sustainable, but just to show some facts, here we are. We started in 2008. We now have 410 employees as of October and more in the coming months. We have sold over 5 million products in 2015 alone, and our wage is now at 70% above legal minimum. We have 32 stores in the Philippines. We have presence in Abu Dhabi, in Singapore, Malaysia, and in the USA, and we're also opening in Indonesia. We have almost 100,000 dealers or advocates. We have 6 partner communities that we work with. And then we also have 15 partner social enterprises that we have in our stores. Because we have 32 stores all over the Philippines, we are also able to distribute and help other social entrepreneurs to have distribution. So now we only have 15, but come Christmas time, it's going to be 27. So despite all of this, you would think, do they work? So now, if you look at this, we've been featured in so many different magazines, side by side Chanel, side by side Estee Lauder. So there is also credibility in terms of the efficacy of what we actually come up with. And so even Cosmopolitan, the magazine, featured us to be 2016's best products, if you look at the picture on the lower right side. So thank you. So I just leave you with it and just kind of explain that me being someone who does not have business background, but with my interest in cosmetics and just with the passion and the values and the faith that has been taught to us by our father, we are able to achieve certain things. And I hope this could also challenge all the students here to be able to think further than yourselves and to think further out of the box and to think further beyond dreaming just for your own dreams, but also for the rest of society. Thank you.
Merci beaucoup. Merci beaucoup, Camille. Thank you. Sorry. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Right, so now we have our third and last dream builder who Mr. Melotto brought here, and then the floor will be yours. He is a Parisian from Paris. He's called Louis Faure, and he started as a voluntary worker in Tony's community. You may have heard about the chickens from the Fabien mentioned. Well, they find themselves, they end up with Louis because he wants to offer high quality chickens raised by local farmers. He's got a special ecosystem. He's going to talk about this after 2 years of experience there in the Philippines, and give him a round of applause, please. Welcome, Louis.
Bonsoir.
Good evening. It is an honor for me to talk to you in front of after such amazing people. So today I was catching the train from Paris to Grenoble with a friend, and it's the first time that he was having a look at the European countryside of a developed country. And it was strange for me to see that he was surprised to see so many trees, cows, small villages, and to say that Paris is, compared to Manila, is rather a small capital. So I realized that our countries have undergone a form of development that's very special, and that looks more like the city or the defense district than the countryside. So it brought me back 2 years ago when I was a student, and I thought that, well, it's not working. Yes, it does. I was proudly turned towards the future and was looking at the future trustingly, and I was in an environment that was also aiming towards the La Défense, the business district, maybe the Silicon Valley. But 40 years ago, Silicon Valley was not so different from the countryside that there is between Paris and Grenoble. So as a result of what my friend Vincent said, is that I realized that there was a discrepancy between the ways dreams had been made. So I find it difficult to understand what was behind what we were learning. There are so many management schools in France that give the students the tools to change things, but all the same, we're in a world where inequality increases. So I decided to go as far as I could to think out of the box, to leave the walls of Paris and then end up in the Philippines countryside. First day I got there, I joined the course with Tony Melotto, and his question to the student was to say, what is your dream? What? And I realized nobody had ever asked me that. And something else sprang back to mind, and I thought, I feel like traveling, get onto a plane, go and swim with sharks. And those students who were sons of farmers who come from squatters area, they said, I want to put an end to poverty for my family and for my country. And all of a sudden, I understood the gap between those who had nothing and could dream so high, and me, who was lucky enough to be born in the right place at the right time, who had such a limited ambition that was limited to myself. So I was curious, and that's what kept me there for 2 months, and then I spent there 6 years. I wanted to go further and try and understand how did they get this energy, which I didn't even found with my close friends, in my close friends. So I started spending people who were twice as old as me, didn't even speak English properly. And I had to make sure that the animals we were growing, the cattle we had, actually carried on growing. So which competences did I have? Which skills did I have that I could have used for? How could I help these people? So I had lots of things to unlearn and more to learn. That was fascinating. The first thing I understood, the first thing I had to learn, was to discover this love that Fabien mentions when he's called Kuya, understand the relationship that people are able to build between each other. So the idea, first of all, you have to accept the coffee or kill the chicken when you decide to do so. That's how I spent my time. Well, my friends, you know, I was killing chickens for 20 hours on end under the mango trees, transfer also the chicks into various areas. So I have to come back to the beginning. And maybe I realized that what I'd been missing. I met lots of friends who've set up their own business and say, well, I said, well, I'm on a service system. And I realized that our generation also has a need to be producing something. Don't forget that we're in a world where there'll be 9 billion people. We have to produce more, but better. And there's a part of the population that's completely left out. So a few months later, I was there. I wasn't talking to people. I was talking to chickens. I didn't have any shoes because I realized that I had to be made aware of the fact that these people who were poor because they had values that were never enhanced in a business or included in a business model that could actually make use of them. So I realized there were lots of resources. There are 10 million surface of land that are unexploited, and farmers that have no access to the knowledge. There's 100 a million market there in the Philippines. They have to import food. For me, as a business ex-business student, there was a resource, there was a market, the knowledge. Why not start? So I say, why chicken? Well, okay, it's a nice chick, isn't it? It's a female chick. Now I know. I know how to find out the difference. But the idea is, no, in order for her to have further chicks, of course, I couldn't do that on my own. I had to work with people. So I had to create a relationship with people. That's why now I work with Vincent. Vincent is only 18. We'll talk about him later. And without Vincent, I couldn't do anything. Where you say, okay, you're white, you're good to Filipinos, you're going to work with a young Filipino. We know that. You're going to help him come out of poverty. But if I work with Vincent, is because I wouldn't do anything without him. He brings something, I bring something. It's the fact that we're working together that enables us to have a company like Free Birds, and that Ducasse, this major cook, actually uses our chickens, cooks our chickens. So now let Vincent tell his story, just to say that we come from two different worlds, but now two worlds apart, but now we've learned to be together and walk in the same direction.
Good evening to all of you. Yes, my name is Vincent and I'm only 18 years old. Our family is one of the beneficiaries of Gawit Kalinga, and we have been living in Jika Enchanted Farm for almost 8 years. And you know, all of these things is really unthinkable for me. To even, you know, go here in France or to even ride in a plane, it's really unimaginable for a person like me coming from a different part of the world. You know, it's really all because of Gawit Kalinga. It's really all because of people like them who decided to go out of their comfort zone and go out of their ivory towers. It's really about all of them who really believes in the vision, who started to dream, not only for themselves, but also for the people like us. And, you know, today, because of them, we're now living in a decent house. Both of my parents are working. My father is a former garbage collector, but he's now a vermiculturist. He makes fertilizers out of worms. My mother now is part of the housekeeping team of the farm. My two siblings are almost graduating in high school, and I've got these 2 years of study in social entrepreneurship in the farm. And, you know, I got this opportunity to go here. And, you know, it's really an everyday battle for us. We're just so lucky that there are people like them who really see the value of the people like me, who can't even see the value of themselves. You know, I came from a world where we have to cheat, we have to steal, and we have to steal, or we have to lie in order for us to survive. And today, I'm really clear that I don't have to do those things, because raising chickens is better than stealing. It's better than selling drugs. It's better than selling your body. And, you know, it's really not about the chicken, but it's really about their love. It's about the trust. It's about the faith. That even if we have a different world, there's something that really connect the two of us. And if they demand greatness in me, I really have to demand also greatness in myself. So it's really about character building. It's really about me and learning a lot of things. And I used to say this, that, you know, about chickens, about knowledge, you can easily Google it. But for you to become honest, for you to become hardworking, for you to think about other people, for you to think about your country, you cannot Google it. So it's really something within this and within your heart. So for me to imagine, I think it's not really enough. I have to use my hands. So I have to wake up every day at 5 a.m. in the morning. I have to sacrifice. I have to stop my biases. We're not supposed to have a girlfriend or a boyfriend until we graduate. And I know it's really about being better. And I believe, and I'm dreaming that I can end poverty for myself, for my family, and my country with them. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah. Merci beaucoup. Merci pour votre témoignage.
Thank you very much for your words, for what you said. So the last half hour we now could spend it with Tony Maloto. I asked Victoria Gomez to actually join me here on the stage. Where are you, Victoria? Where? And also the team of the Impact Association, led by Antonio. Victoria and the Impact team, please. So, Antonio. how are we going to go about things? Well, we're going to ask him to sit here. Victoria, would you like to come here? Come, come and join me here. Sit on the stage. You're at home. Welcome. Don't stand up. Sit down. Yes. Good. So this association called IMPACT has been working on sustainable development and social businesses, and they've also highlighted a few questions that they will ask Mr. Melotto. And I've said to them that I adore young people. We've had amazing examples, basically. And this association has been working on those issues and actually decides to act. In the field of microcredit, I think you started an electric car competition to make people aware of soft mobility and also the special sort of locally produced baskets. Then you're going to be interested in chicken. So we're going to give you the floor, just give you two pieces of information, because the World Forum is a place where production takes place. There were three co-creation spaces that got together today around social businesses, Ronalpia and Enactus. They worked hard. They said it. You'll see their account, the summary of their working day on the World Forum site. What we do every day is we give consulting. It's a consulting network in the sustainable field of the sustainable development. They actually go and see people and do some surveys. And every day, we ask them to give us three good ideas, because it will feed a very important database for the World Forum. Three specific actions, tangible actions, you know, not stories, that have been implemented by various businesses. We'll talk about that on Friday in Paris, because they have to do with CSR indicators that could be integrated in employees' compensation. Second action, soft mobility, the one you're working on, a business to foster bike mobility. And so they suggest to set up a workshop to repair the bikes when need be. Third action, to go and meet consumers, exchange. 76% of the Europeans are aware of the sustainability of their consumption. So the idea is to hear what they have to say, know what their contributions could be, to try and basically adapt to what might be needed. So these are three ideas, three actions that will be fed into our database. So we'll take 15 minutes with your questions, and then we'll finish with, we'll listen to Mr. Tony Melotto, who came with all his team, and that's fantastic that he came here with his team. Thank you. Thank you for doing all this work. For those of you who don't know him, I'd like to introduce him in English so that he can understand.
Antonio Melotto, often called Tito Tony, was a well-paid purchasing manager in one of the biggest firms of the world, Procter & Gamble, when he completely changed his way of life to become a social entrepreneur. In 1995, he founded a youth development program for gang members and juvenile delinquents in Philippines. It was the beginning of Gawad Kalinga, his global movement that built sustainable communities in slum areas. The final goal of his movement is to end poverty for 5 million families in Philippines by 2024. Thank you, sir. So my first question for you will be, like, you were working at Procter & Gamble, one of the biggest firms of the world. What makes you change your ideas and beginning a social entrepreneur?
Well, it was very personal. I was a father to four children at that time, and I was getting ahead in my career, went to a top business school, worked for a multinational, and live in comfort. But the world was not getting any better, and the streets were not safe for my children, because those of us who were privileged with the best education were isolated in our artificial bubble of comfort and safety, while poverty was deepening around us, the slums were getting bigger, climate change vulnerability forced many of the vulnerable poor living in dangerous areas to come to the city and live as squatters in slums. So it was then I realized that my children had no future in my country, and even if they were successful abroad, as long as my country remained third world, they will still be seen as second-class citizens of a third world country. So I guess I realized that our country is blessed with abundance of natural resources, and 9.6 million hectares of fertile land, and 100 million talented, creative human capital. And the poor at the bottom of the pyramid, they were the untapped wealth. So I decided that while people were really just focused on their personal career, personal comfort, I had to really look for the future of my family. And it was not just in the Philippines, but poverty that existed in other countries. They will not provide a better world for my family. So I realized that I had to get out of the train, and I had to go to the biggest slum and work with over 2,000 gang members, drug dealers, prostitutes, just for me to understand the depth of the poverty and how I could really restore human dignity and build sustainable communities with them as partners, not as beneficiaries.
And the name of your NGO is Gawat Kalinga. Could you explain us what it means?
Gawat Kalinga is a Filipino word that means to give care, like a mother nurturing a child. So it's a deep kind of caring. Because when we also take care of the poor, we have to consider them as family, then we will not abandon them, we'll not abuse them. So I realized that my purpose in life is to build a world where no one is an enemy or a victim. And that everyone, as a radical optimist, I had to develop my optimism that we can be life givers and nurturers and hope builders.
So you're talking about hope. A guy before, maybe Fabien, talked about the companies you're working with, like Air France KLM, Nestlé. Do you think it's really social awareness or social washing?
Well, I guess that's very trendy because we live in a world, you know, that has also become cynical. But I've worked with over 700 major corporations. I work for one, and I think many people here have worked for these corporations, and many go to a top business school so that they can also find their own career in those corporations. So I never saw them as an enemy, but we realize that they have changed, have to change a lot of their own business practices. But if I can show them that we can really build a business just like what Camille has done, where she started her business at the age of 22, and she's now 30 years old. But her company, Human Nature, that has a no-firing policy, is now the biggest natural cosmetic company in the Philippines. And she's not just in 32 branches, she's practically in every major mall. So I guess we have to show that we can do a bottom-up approach, not always, but we need big corporations to also discover that doing good makes good business sense. So we partner with them to provide scholarships, like Air France. Air France built 60 homes for the poorest families in a slum area where I started, and they also provided scholarship for our first batch of students. In fact, Vincent is a scholar of Air France. And so now he's back in France to inspire the French. You know, we have to really see the good in people, the good in corporations, the good in government, the good in each other. So like, for instance, why I see the good in Fabian and Louis, they're like my sons. And so I came to realize that we have to build a global family. I have a daughter who's married to a European. So 6 of my grandchildren are Europeans. So I have to really build Asia as home for Europeans, as I see that Europe is my home. And for me personally, my home in Europe is France. And now because...
You were talking about your son, your daughter. Could you give advice to people like us, some of us at least, who want to become social entrepreneurs?
Please do not be afraid to be different so you can make a difference. Don't be afraid to go out of your comfort zone. Don't be afraid, about... because your greatest enemy is your fear. The fear inhibits you from discovering your potential for greatness. So it's fear that will make you mediocre. And don't embrace mediocrity. Go for greatness.
You were talking about like Europe. Do you think that your model that you're applying in Philippines could work in other places in the world? Like it could be an international model of development?
Poverty is the same everywhere. So the poverty in the Philippines is similar to the poverty in Indonesia. We're building communities for 20,000 families in Jakarta. So I've built communities in Papua New Guinea for the tribal indigenous communities. And I believe that last year, I went to Togo, to Benin, I went to Gabon, to South Africa, and I feel that there is so much that we can do together. So if I'm inviting people from France, and I'm inviting also people from Africa, please come to the Philippines and see how we can really build sustainable communities with rich and poor as partners, with a bottom-up and a top-down approach, and with people who can really see the entire value chain, that we have to think of people like Vincent, of the poor, as people who can think beyond micro. So again, there should be no limit to our dreams, and it is not about just about the privilege of degree or pedigree, but it is important for us to really discover, that the greatness of the human spirit. So my dream is that before I get too old, because I'm 66 years old now, is that I really would like to start Gawad Kalinga in Africa, especially in the French-speaking countries of Africa, because in the Philippines, we had over 1,000 French interns from 22 universities who helped us build our farm village university. And Fabian used to laugh at me 5 years ago when I said, this is going to be the Silicon Valley. This is going to be the Harvard and for social education and the Disneyland. And now we are looking at about 100,000 visitors every year. And it is now starting. Our farm village university is graduating people like Vincent and thousands of people like them. So again, we can just show that it can be done, even if it's small. But then again, you surround yourself with people who have a lot of competencies, a lot of resources that you do not have. You cannot do it alone. And I could not have built our farm village university without the French. And that's why we only allow the French flag to be flown in our farm village university, because we feel that it was the destiny that brought them there, because we have no historical affinity with France, but we have grown such a deep affection. And now Camille, when she put up together with her sister and my and, and my son-in-law Dylan, when they put up Human Nature, they only buy their ingredients in Europe now from France. So she's going to Marseille, she buys her lavender here. So because of this, we are now bridging even the market of Europe with Asia. And we would like you, you know, to come up with the most brilliant ideas so that we can really create wealth that does not leave anyone behind to remain poor.
I think you're going to receive a lot of curriculum vitae. Another question. We heard a lot about your new president, Rodrigo Duterte. Will it have an impact, you think, on your action? And what do you think about it for Philippines?
You see, I stay away from politics and religion. Because I'm always about the poor. And you see, politicians have a term of office. My love for my country and for the poor has no term of office. You know, we produce products, you know, but my own love for the poor has no expiration date, and products have expiration dates. So I was offered before this by two governments to be a minister. And I realized from my calling from the very beginning was just to be an ordinary citizen so that I will have solidarity with also the most ordinary of our people. So I value the power. I value the freedom to serve my country, not the power to rule it. So again, I would like, because in our country, the root of poverty are, you know, I would say social injustice, the inequity in distribution of wealth, it's corrupt politics, it is fanatical religion, it is, again, also the disconnection of the most privileged from the least fortunate. So those are the things I want to address. But I also try to not depend on government for support. And in the last election, all the four candidates for president had partnership with us. Because we don't judge our politicians, we engage them. And we were told that politicians are corrupt. But again, who am I to judge? Because we live in a compromised world. But I came to realize that even our work is to transform criminals to be good citizens. So if I engage every, because I've engaged over 1,000 mayors, governors, senators, presidents, not a single one of them tried to corrupt me. So I realized I simply have to be honest. And we will create a brand that is honest. You attract also a lot of honest people. I surround myself with young people like you because you're less corrupted, you're less polluted, right? So again, let's keep the integrity of the work that we're doing because, you know, if we anchor our own business on values, then it will last. So right now, when I am asked about my comments, I said, I leave all political comments to politicians, but I will only work with people who will help end poverty with me.
The last question.
One last question. So you did a lot of things for Philippines and for the world, but what's your dream, actually?
Wow. I in 1996, I gave up my credit card, my checking account. I didn't carry money in my pocket. I realized that I had to give up my own ambition for myself. Then I came, but then what amazed me was that I have been overwhelmed by life's generosity. You know, and so by dreaming for the poor and helping them also to grow their, because the poor have been deprived of their capacity to dream. You know, I don't have to ask anything. I don't have to desire anything. By not wanting anything for myself, I get everything. So I get invited here. You know, I get to stay in a hotel. Air France flies me here and so on. So I came to realize that this is a really, life is generous. So as long as I don't desire anything only for selfish reason, if it's for the good of others, then, you know, then others will be generous to me. So my dream right now is for you to have a beautiful life.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much. Merci beaucoup.
Thank you very much. Thank you to the Impact Association team. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I propose to conclude in a few minutes with your slides. Okay? At the perpetrator. Merci beaucoup.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon. I'm so overwhelmed by the presence of Muhammad Yunus and how he has inspired the world to really think for those at the least, the last, and the lost. But I'm also overwhelmed because they gave me a PowerPoint and I do not know how to operate it. I don't know. Oh, yes. You see, I always I realize that this whole world is not about me, but it's always about us. And that it's anything is not for me to own, but it is for me to be a steward. And so we have been given the gift of life, and I realize that life has a purpose. And my purpose has been defined to me after I went after my own dream. I came from the bottom of the pyramid, and it was education that gave me also the opportunity to go to the top university, to go for the big multinational job, only to realize, you know, that, you know, after getting what I wanted, I was actually holding an empty bag, because other people's lives were empty. And I was not whole because I was so disconnected from the things that were of value in my life. And so I went to the slums to be able to discover, to find what I have lost. And it was, the poor became my biggest mentors. They taught me how to love. They taught me how to persevere. See, that's how I am oftentimes oppressed by my own children. And they keep me humble, they keep me grounded. And so again, they prepare these slides that help me in my journey. It's just a way of helping you walk through memory lane in the way that today we had something very nostalgic, celebrating the 10th anniversary of the victory of Muhammad Yunus, who has actually opened the eyes of the world to the world of possibilities, you know, by also seeing the poor not as a burden but as a blessing, but seeing them as not as a liability but as real wealth and asset. So our mission was to provide land for the landless, home for the homeless, food for the hungry, and so we started to really build homes, communities. But it was through the power of solidarity, and that's why I have such a deep affinity with the French. And I think they're most attracted to Gawad Kalinga because it resonates with your own spirit of equality, fraternity, and also solidarity, and our ability to transform slums, shanties into beautiful communities. And it's about restoration of human dignity to begin with. And so this is our challenge, and that's what we're trying to do from building communities. We actually now have over 3,000 communities because after every typhoon, we also get the opportunity to really harness our beneficiaries from past typhoons to become now our benefactors. They're the ones who are our volunteers. So, but what to do next? Okay. sorry. So again, Fabian showed you this. And so we're building now this new prototype, because our goal is to be able to replicate this in 24 other farm village universities throughout the country. So it constitutes a village, means family, community, farm means business, food sufficiency, productivity, and university. We have our students from the poorest communities around the country. So we are now on our third batch. Vincent, who's 18, was part of the first batch. He entered our college at the age of 16, and he got a certificate after 2 years as a social entrepreneur. He's now into his gap year in agribusiness. But like him, many of them come from rebel territories, come from slums throughout the Philippines, but they are our undiscovered wealth, and we want them to shine just like Vincent. So they are the brightest from the striving poor. And two of them just got a scholarship, a four-year scholarship to ESSEC, France. And they are children of unschooled farmers. So again. And these girls now are doing their BBA in ESSEC, Singapore, and they do their last 2 years in Sergi, and I heard they're doing very well. They just went through their own legal studies, but like Vincent just learned how to speak English 2 years ago, and he also had to learn French. That's how also we honor our partnership with France, that our students have to speak English and French. And so so our interns have to also do volunteer work in terms of tutorials, teaching our students how to speak French. Because again, why French? Because it gives them, you know, a higher self-esteem. Because in our country, we associate France with quality, with excellence, with class. And that's what we're giving the poor, is not charity, but the gift of excellence. And APEC did their own event here with us, global leaders, young people. So this is in our Farm Village University, and this January we're doing our own social business summit. We expect about 1,000 entrepreneurs from all over the world, and many of them, we will be honoring France in our social business summit, because they were the ones that really helped us to really discover the power of solidarity between rich and poor, local and international. We're now creating a global platform, a global ecosystem. So now human nature can buy their ingredients, and we can get our technology from France, but France can also get their chocolates from the Philippines, because you're all addicted to chocolates, but you don't grow a single cacao tree. So we will, in 10 years, there will be a shortage of chocolate, and we will save you from dying, you know, if you, so you come and plant more cacao trees with us, okay? So you know that guy. So he does a lot of our farm tours. It's interesting that it's a Frenchman touring Filipinos in our country. So we have also the French taking care of our goats. We have those from agri-schools here in France. And this was built by Hyundai. They are not giving us corporate social CSR charity, but they're giving us corporate social investment. So when corporations deal with us, it's just like investing in the World Cup. They want brand visibility. So we go co-branding, and that's and my own corporate background helps me to relate with corporate CEOs, so that we can really that help them see that doing good makes a lot of business sense, because bringing people out of poverty will create bigger markets. So this is, well, this is our restaurant, but it's being knocked down because Berjaya is putting in 30 million to build our culinary center. So from just a plain restaurant, now our dream of building our Silicon Valley is becoming a reality. So Fabian is not laughing anymore. So this is our bamboo palace. We have an infinity pool. So, we also have our world-class spa. No, so when interns stay with us, their parents also who like some, you know, comfortable affinities, they can stay in our spa. And what does this spa do for the poor? It also exposes them to higher standards. So it really prepares them to really go for quality. So it elevates also the self-esteem and the self-image of people like Vincent, who have never been exposed to quality. So, I don't know, we blend profit and purpose, competencies and compassion for inclusive wealth creation. We have, human nature has 150 SKUs. When we wake up in the morning in the farm, the toothpaste we use is made by us, the shampoo, the soap, the bread is baked by us, the peanut butter we make. When our students plant peanuts, they make peanut butter. We teach them the entire value chain. So again, it has been a difficult journey for us because we don't have these competencies, but somehow it's an open platform that attracts also not only goodwill, but also the genius of people. So he's a Taiwanese who decided to do peanut butter, and it was chosen by Yummy Magazine, a top magazine, as the best peanut butter in Manila. So again, you go for quality. Social business need not be a pity purchase. It has to be a top quality. Our Bayani Brew, we started out just as a blend concocted by the mothers in the community, is now being distributed in 1,000 stores throughout. It includes 7-Eleven, Mini Stop. It used to be just distributed by human nature. So we are building a walang iwanan economy. It means build an economy that does not leave anyone behind to remain poor. So we are now building an army of social entrepreneurs from the bright poor. And these are some of our students. They make rice cakes. They now are planting 10 hectares of rice, but we will be doing a lot of value adding. So he's taking care of ducks. And we are now making duck burger. And our duck burger, we entered into a competition at a high-end mall. And we won as the best burger in Manila. Our duck burger beat Angus beef. So he's our entrepreneur who comes also. He's a classmate of Vincent. Our entrepreneurs also building the Human Nature Park. And so these are our landscapers. We teach them also about the concept of beauty, because being poor, many of them used to live in garbage. They were treated like garbage. They saw themselves as garbage. Now we're teaching them also that they're a beautiful creation and that they can also create beauty. So now this is a fish pond. So we are also teaching our students how to develop our aquatic resources. We now have people here doing bamboo nuggets because they're doing vegetarian food. So instead of chicken nuggets, they're making bamboo nuggets, and they're really fantastic. And this is a guy, Gary, who used to work in a quail farm. He got really subhuman wages, but we decided to give him capital to put up his quails, and he makes now quail eggs, which the whole community can absorb. So now he is on his way to raising 400 quails. These are little birds that lay eggs that is also common food in our country. So these are the partners of Vincent. As you can see, they have the French Sasu. So we even breed the birds, the French Sasu and the American North Hampshire. So we also try to get the best breed, which we can now also provide as breeding stock for our farmers. So this is our rice field, and our students are planting the rice, but they will be able to also harvest the rice, and we will be building our own rice mill. So as you can see, this is when they work together, they eat together. I would like you to see how beautiful our students. These are children of the poorest families, but they were wearing Jimmy Choo shoes during their graduation ball. So as we also wanted the poor not to see themselves, you know, as just objects of pity, but as really world-class citizen of a country that's rising out of poverty. These are our men. As you can see, you can spot Vincent there. That's Vincent. And his date was a French intern, Marion, who was here today. So this is our countryside fair. And these are just our students. And as you can see, our French. You see how happy they are. This is again Margot, who is staying with us for a year. And Gaspar, who quit his job here, and he's staying with us forever. So I don't know. You know, so like Fabian, I told him when he first just started, go home. I told him, I sent him home 3 times, but he kept coming back. So I think this is just in a way for us to really see. We're rural based, we're focused on agribusiness. We have a bottom-up approach. we get the rich and the poor to partner, not the poor to be the owner and the not the rich as the owner and the poor as his laborer, but they are partners like Fabia, again Louis and Vincent. We get men and women as partners. So in our country, our criminals are men, our drug dealers are men, our rebels are men. We realize if men are the problem, they should also be part of the solution. And somehow social entrepreneurship, where we can now think not just micro but also macro, attracts a lot of men. So together we can end poverty. And so today I just want you to become radical optimists. Please see the world, you know, as a world, you know, that might have a lot of conflict, a lot of difficulty, but it is a world that will be better because the young people now are trying to really learn from not only the good things that my generation has done, but will actually correct the mistakes that we have made. And so please do not be afraid of the future. Do not be afraid, you know, of the problems that you see today, but be optimistic, be hopeful, and rejoice that the solution to the problems you see today is you. And this world will be a better place because of you. God bless you.
Marie, la photo.
Marie, it's time for the photo call. Can we stand up so that we can take a photo with Tony? I'm going to ask Fabien and Camille and Louis and Vicenti to stand up. Stand up, everybody. Please be polite and wait 30 seconds before you leave. So if you'd like to stand here, please. You do it. I don't know how to do it. You can raise your arms, smile, do something.
Très bien.
Oh, bah attends, non, attends, regarde, j'ai plus rien. C'est... Voilà, merci. OK. Allez, levez les bras.
So raise your arms. Thank you very much. Philippe, would you like to come say bye-bye? Just 30 seconds. Earlier on, a young lady called Corinne said, thank you for coming to Grenoble. I'd just like to reverse the proposal. Thank you to Grenoble for receiving us. Thank you to the management school and the Chamber of Commerce. We were very happy and very impressed to be here. And you added something, I believe. Can I repeat it? You said that you changed, that we changed your day. I must have heard it wrong. Maybe you said you've changed my life. If we've contributed to that, I think that's a very good thing. What we wanted to demonstrate today, and some people can be skeptical about this, you know, we've had a difficult time for 10 years. We know that we can do things differently. Another economy is possible. Collective responsibility can be exercised. I think it depends on each and every one of us. Thank you.
Bonne soirée à tous et merci.
Have a great evening and